So just now you heard Siobhán playing tunes and Eibhlís singing songs of the old harpers, and to get an impression of their sound world. So what I'm going to talk about now is a bit of the history and where this information comes from and what the harpers were doing at different points in the past. So we're going to start with the last of the old Irish harpers. I think is how he was sometimes marketed. This is Patrick Byrne. When he was a young boy, he came to Belfast to come to the Irish Harp Society school to learn the harp. So he learned to play the harp. I'm not sure how old he was, a young teenager, I suppose. And this would be in the early 1800s. He was at the Harp Society school in Belfast, and he was taught by Edward McBride. And Edward McBride was taught by Arthur O'Neill, and Siobhán mentioned Arthur O'Neill, and we'll come back to him later on. So he had a solid lineage, and he learned the harp from people who'd learned, from people who'd been taught, in a lineage going right back to the old harpers in the old indigenous tradition. But he didn't have any students. After he died in 1863, he had no students, and he didn't pass the harp music on at all. And this is why we call him one of the last of the harpers. And this is kind of interesting from our point of view, trying to play the old Irish harp music, that we don't have a living tradition passed right down to the present day, in the way that somebody like Eibhlís, for example, does have a living tradition of song that she can learn from and be part of. The old Irish harp tradition came to an end with this generation in the 19th century. So that turns it suddenly from being a traditional art that you can just plug into by going and learning from the old masters to being a historical exercise that you have to look back and try and find out stuff from people and about people who are dead and gone. So we can try and find out about Patrick Byrne. And there's a newspaper article in Chambers' Edinburgh Journal, written by somebody who'd been to one of Patrick Byrne's concert performances. And he says, "If we could judge at all from one instance, we would say that an Irish harper may yet be a respectable person. A worthy representative of the fraternity, Mr. Patrick Byrne, a pupil of the Belfast Academy, is a well-informed, modest, and agreeable man, of perfectly virtuous habits, as well as a delightful performer on his instrument. We had the great pleasure of hearing him about 3 years ago in Edinburgh, where he attended private parties for a moderate fee and was generally esteemed." So you suddenly get a sense of Patrick Byrne out playing at private house concerts, not charging too much money, being very genteel and, you know, behaving himself well and fitting into that sort of the gentry and the well-to-do and the well-bred in society. So here's Patrick Byrne. He's posing. When he was in Edinburgh, Hill and Adamson were busy inventing photography in the 1840s, and so they were always looking for interesting things to take photographs of, and they dragged poor blind Byrne into their studio and sat him, I think it's outside the garden to get the full sunlight, to get enough light for the picture. So they sat him there with his harp, maybe a minute or maybe 10 minutes he had to sit like this while they did their exposure and produced their photographic series. So he's sitting with his harp, and this is one of the harps that the Dublin harp maker John Egan made for the Belfast Harp Society, when the Harp Society in Belfast had been set up to teach these young lads in the early 1800s. They needed harps, of course, to teach the boys on. And they sent to Dublin to John Egan, who was Ireland's premier harp maker. Now Egan, his speciality was making the big classical pedal harps, like you see on the left-hand side here. This was Egan's main business. I haven't yet found out where Egan learned to do this. My guess is that he must have gone to London and apprenticed with somebody like Erard, one of the big classical pedal harp makers. But those were Egan's main business. They're a very good instrument. They're still sought after nowadays. The second type that he made was, this is Patrick Byrne's harp, which we tracked down and found. It's in a private collection in the States now. And this is the best picture I've managed to get of it. But so this is, so Egan produced these Irish harps for the Belfast Harp Society. And they have brass wire strings to give that very distinctive, long, resonating sound that you heard when Siobhán was playing there. Very, very different from the classical pedal harp. And Egan was a great innovator. He was one of those inventors who always was looking for things to improve, to problems to solve, ways to make new products to sell on the market, because it was the great age of entrepreneurs and capitalism. And so Egan could sell the classical pedal harps to people who were playing in the Anglo-Continental classical music tradition. He could sell his brass wire-strung Irish harps to the society schools who were keeping going the old indigenous tradition. But there was a kind of, he saw a gap in the market. There were people who didn't want to appear to be Anglo-classical with their classical pedal harps, but they were people who were swimming in the Anglo-classical musical world and had no contact with the society schools and the old tradition. And so he invented a new Irish harp. And in his advertising, he's very proud of it. New, improved, portable Irish harp, he says. Strung with gut, the same as the pedal harp. And yet it's small and curvy and covered in shamrocks, so it gives you that, it gives you the Irish flavour, and yet it's an Anglo-Continental type of instrument. And he was very good at advertising and very successful. I mean, people at the time understood what it was. And understood the difference. So our reviewer continues, let it not be supposed that the Irish music may nevertheless be preserved and played on other instruments. No one who has heard the Irish harp, Byrne's harp, could imagine such a thing. When we hear Moore's Irish melodies played on the pianoforte or even on the pedal harp, we do not hear the same music which O'Cahan, Carolan or Hempson played. It's as much altered as Homer in the translation of Pope. For the true presentment of this music to modern ears, we require the old sets as preserved by the volumes of Bunting, and the Irish harp played by an Irish harper. This instrument, it must be remembered, is of particular structure. It contains about 30 brass wires, the twang of which give the music a striking metallic brilliancy. The high notes are given with the left hand, reserving the more powerful for the deep notes of the bass. And so here's Patrick Byrne, who they were talking about. He's the Irish harper, playing his Irish harp with brass wire strings. You can see he's got it on the left side, his left hand in the treble, and his right hand in the bass. And he's playing the old sets of music that he's got from his teacher, who got it from Arthur O'Neill, who got it from the old tradition. And I find it kind of interesting that this newspaper reviewer doesn't even mention the little miniature portable harps that Egan's invented. He sees a clear distinction in his mind between the brass wire strung Irish harp and the pedal harp in the classical world, in the same world as a piano. And I find that very interesting to try and see how these different instruments and different traditions fit together. So Patrick Byrne learned to play the harp in the old Irish tradition, playing the harp with brass wire strings at the Belfast School, run by the Irish Harp Society in the early 1800s. Now his teacher there was Edward McBride, and Edward McBride was also a student at the school earlier on. And that was at the beginning of the school when Arthur O'Neill was the teacher. Now here's Arthur O'Neill sitting under a tree. Arthur O'Neill didn't learn to play the harp at a charitable harp society school. He learned to play the harp out in the countryside from Owen Keenan, who was another itinerant harper. So Arthur O'Neill is kind of like a different kind of thing. He learned out in the countryside in the living indigenous tradition. There was no need for charitable support for Arthur to learn the harp. He's right in there as a genuine tradition bearer in the old school. And Arthur O'Neill's a fascinating man for lots of reasons. He gave bunting a lot of interesting tunes and interesting settings of tunes. We don't have the first manuscripts that Bunting wrote from Arthur O'Neill, but we have piano arrangements where I think Bunting is trying to show aspects of Arthur O'Neill's harp style on the piano. Arthur O'Neill wrote his autobiography, which is a cracking read, all about life on the road as an Irish harper in the early 18th century. And we have some copies available outside that you can buy and take away and read. It's worth reading. It's very entertaining, lots of anecdotes of Carol Anne and the other harpers. And I've put this harp up beside. This harp is one of the surviving 18th century harps. It's in the Ulster Museum in the centre of town. Some people think that this was Arthur O'Neill's harp. I don't think so. I think this is Victorian storytelling and romance making. But it's called the O'Neill harp. And one of the reasons I don't think it's Arthur O'Neill's harp is you can see it's not the same instrument as in his portrait, but there's other reasons as well. But still, it's interesting as a surviving instrument. And we're always interested in the old harps in the museums because they're fascinating objects and they can tell us a lot about the music. More of that in a bit. Arthur O'Neill was there in the exchange rooms at the famous meeting of the harpers in 1792, which was organised by the great and good of Belfast. Partly, I think, as a political thing, and partly as a genuine artistic thing to record the music of the Irish harpers, because by the 1790s, the tradition really was dying out. There weren't really many, if any, young people playing the Irish harp. It was all old men who didn't really have any students. The only reason Arthur O'Neill had students was because the organisers of the meeting organised a charity school. Do you see what I mean? The tradition was kind of, this was it, and they realised if there's going to be any record of what these old men played, it would have to be done now, because in 10 years' time, they would be dead. And so they organised a meeting over the course of a couple of days in the exchange rooms, and they offered prize money to any harpers who turn up and play old Irish tunes, and they paid Edward Bunting to come to the meeting and write down the music. And Edward Bunting, I think he was like a musical genius. I think he was one of those people who could hear a tune and just copy it out straight away. He was kind of hyper-literate and with a very good ear. And he was, as Siobhán said, he was only a teenager when he got this job. And when he came to the exchange rooms, he sat down, he wrote down at speed the tunes that the harpers were playing. And his imagination seems to have been fired by this idea that you could take down the oral tradition, unwritten music. You could write it with an aim to publishing it. And he seems to have got this idea that was an amazing piece of cultural work. And so over the rest of his life, on and off, he travelled around all parts of the north of Ireland, I would think, as far out as Mayo, and up to McGilligan in County Derry, and south to County Armagh, to visit the harpers, to go to their houses, to sit beside them, to write down their tunes, and to get their tradition off them. Here he is, when he was much older, looking very thoughtful. I think he was a very interesting man in lots of respects. And this is the work that he did. So this is his work, okay? So let me try and explain what's going on here. On the left-hand side is Dennis Hempson, the harper of McGilligan, sitting blind, 100 years old, hunchback, with the downhill harp, which Siobhán was playing a copy of. Here's the harp. After Hempson died, it went to the local big house, and then eventually it made its way to the market, and it was bought and given to Guinness, and they have it in their storehouse museum in Dublin, in their advertising department. So there it is in its glass case. And this is members of the Historical Harp Society of Ireland on one of our annual field trip tours where we go and see the harps. And so this is Dennis O'Hampsey's harp. I mean, that's kind of cool. There it is. And there's Dennis O'Hampsey in the picture, sitting and playing it and posing for his portrait. And then at the top here, this is the little tiny field notebook, the little pocketbook that Edward Bunting had in his pocket when he went to McGilligan and visited Dennis O'Hampsey at his house and wrote out, I think this might be like a live transcription that he's then reworked. And I think you can see, this is the Lady of the Desert that Siobhán played. And here's the tune. Yeah, da da da, boom, and there's your bass note, and then there's bass notes all along here. And so this is like a kind of a sketch of the complete performance of O'Hampsey. And the reason Bunting wrote this stuff down was he wanted to save the music, so he rearranged it for piano, he published it in music books. He published 3 volumes of piano music, which were quite popular, and they were bought, and they were played on the piano, and they went back into the tradition on other instruments. But we're very lucky because descendants of his family kept the little pocketbooks, and they were discovered by Charlotte Milligan Fox and presented to Queen's University, and that's where they are now. So we don't just have the fashionable piano arrangements, we have the field drafts as well. And so that's kind of amazing to see the working method, and to be able to connect it back to the man, Dennis O'Hampsey, the harp that he played it on, and to have a live transcript of what he was doing. This is Patrick Quinn. Here's the portrait of him sitting with his harp. This would be about 1809, I think, this portrait was done, when he was taken to Dublin. Here's his harp. After he died, we don't really know what happened to it, but it ended up in another of the big houses and eventually made its way to Trinity College, which is where it is now in Dublin. And here's members of the Historical Harp Society of Ireland on our annual field trip going and looking at it. So there's Quinn, with the portrait of Quinn with the harp. There's the actual harp in Trinity College. And there at the top is another of Edward Bunting's pocket notebooks, a different one, slightly later on, because Bunting, I'm not sure that Bunting did copy down tunes when Patrick Quinn was at the meeting in 1792 in Belfast. Quinn was at the meeting, but Bunting didn't take his music down. But later, quite a lot later, about 1800, Bunting did a trip to South Armagh and visited Patrick Quinn and wrote down some of his tunes. And again, this is a live transcript. Patrick Quinn sitting there, just like this, sitting there with the harp, playing a tune, and Bunting is desperately scribbling along, trying to keep up. And you can see, it is the tune here. He's sketched in the bass. He's got it all wrong, and he's had to scribble everything out and start again a few bars later. So you can kind of see this process of the harp playing it. Bunting scribbling along, and you can imagine him saying, wait, stop, I've got it wrong, can you start again from after the first verse? I don't know. And then there's all kind of scribbling around it about writing down the name of the tune and different names and inserting little things. So again, you have this little kind of nest of information that you have Patrick Quinn. I mean, you have information about his life, portrait of him sitting there at the harp. You have the actual harp that he sat at with his actual hands and chin were resting on and wearing away the wood. And you have Edward Bunting's page where he writes down all the stuff that was going on. It's like a huge amount of information. These people are long dead. 200 years ago they died. And yet, there's a whole little package of information about them, which is kind of amazing. And of course, there were lots of other harpers as well. There were lots of harpers that we don't have portraits of that I can't show you. So for example, this harp on the very left, we think this belonged to Rose Mooney, who was a woman harper. And this is a reconstruction of Rose Mooney's harp to try and get it up and running to understand her music. So Rose Mooney gave Bunting tunes, as he wrote down in his manuscripts. We have her harp, but we don't have a portrait, so we don't know what she looked like. We don't have that visual image of her hands on the strings. This is the Muller Mast harp, which was in Scotland for a long time, although I think it was in Ireland in the 18th century, and it came back to Ireland in the 20th century, and it's now in the National Museum in Dublin. And some people think that this harper here has the Muller Mast harp. I'm not sure he does. I think this is a different harp. Some people think this harper is Charles Byrne. I don't think it is. I think it's a different person. So, but there's ongoing research and discussion about these things. So this might be a portrait of Charles Byrne with the Muller Mast harp, or it might be a portrait of somebody else with a different harp. But either way, you can see how he's sitting, you can see how he's dressed, you see the way he's got his chin against the top of the harp again, you can see how his left hand's in the treble, his right hand's in the bass, you can tell things about how he was seen by the person who did the drawing. This one here, of course, is rather dark. Portrait is Carol Ann. Carol Ann was swimming in that more genteel, continental Dublin world, composing his songs and his rather Italianate style tunes, and so he has a rather formal oil portrait of himself. We don't know who this person over here is. Some people say it's Cormac O'Kelly, but I don't know why they think that. Some people say it's Arthur O'Neill, but I don't think that's true at all.
That's from the National
Gallery. It's in the National Gallery, yeah, in Dublin.
That painting has been reproduced, there's been a reproduction in Belfast.
So that was done as part of the Arthur O'Neill thing. But you see, I don't think it is Arthur O'Neill. I think it's a different person. And we only have old black and white photographs of this painting, because when I asked the National Museum if we could have a colour reproduction of it, they said it's in too bad condition to unwrap, basically. You know, it needs conserved first. So I'm sure there's more portraits of the 18th century harpers out there in big houses or hidden away. You just have to find them. This is a portrait that was found a few years ago. It's in a private collection in the Netherlands, and it shows this gentleman, William Archdeacon. And it's a rather dark picture, but he's sitting there, he has his harp, and his harp is a different shape to the other ones. It's not as high, and it's not as big, and it's not as slender. And I think that's because it's an older style of harp. This is the nearest match that I found to his harp. It's not his harp, but it's the same kind of shape and size, and it's much older. And so one of the things we do as historical musicians is you start to think about a change over time, that the old tradition wasn't ancient and timeless and unchanging. There was a constant historical change, just as there was in architecture and literature and all the other arts. So 15th century Irish harp music was very different from 18th century Irish harp music. Do you see what I mean? And so you can start digging backwards in time. So the further back you go, the smaller the harps that survive from those times are, and the chunkier and the more intricate and elaborate. The one on the left here is perhaps the most famous old Irish harp. It's the Brian Boru harp that's preserved in Trinity College in Dublin. It's the one that's on the Irish euro coins and the presidential standard and seal and all those kind of things. It's kind of used as a national symbol. It's the one that's on the Guinness label. So it's a very iconic object and symbol, the Brian Boru harp. It's been displayed in Trinity College since the 18th century as a historical artifact. But it's also an actual musical instrument made of wood and metal, and with the marks on it where the player's hands have rested and evidence of how it was used. There's another very similar to the Brian Boru harp in Edinburgh, where it's called the Queen Mary harp. Here it is on the right. This is a complete archaeological reconstruction of it, so you can see what it would have looked like when it was new, with the decoration and fittings and everything. The Queen Mary harp in Edinburgh has had lots of study done on it over the last 8 to 10 years by Dr. Karen Lewis, who did her PhD at Edinburgh studying the old harps that are kept there, the two of them. And she put them through a hospital scanner and did materials analysis to find out what they were made of. And most recently, she got the museum to take little tiny samples and send them away for radiocarbon dating. So the Queen Mary harp, just this year, has been dated to the 14th century, which is very interesting in terms of putting it in a historical and artistic context. Now, we don't have any information on that at all about the Brian Boru harp, because none of that work has yet been done. But one day, hopefully, we'll have scans of the inside and materials analysis, and we'll know exactly what species of wood it's made of, and we'll have radiocarbon dating, so we'll know when it was made, etc., etc. So it's an ongoing process. Here's the Queen Mary harp. There it is, right there. Inside the hospital CAT scanning machine, and then on the screen you can see here's a cross section through it showing the hollow sound box and the front pillar, and there's a plan view of it upside down showing the triangular sound box. So this is a photo that Karen Loomis took when she was in the hospital with the Queen Mary harp having it scanned. And the results can be presented like this. This is a cross section through the scan that she generated and published in a scholarly journal in organology. And we could spend the rest of the afternoon just chatting about this slide if you wanted to, because there's so much going on here. You can see these are the holes where the tuning pins go into. You can see the woodwork. You can see the way the joint is made and slotted in. Here's the other joint here, slotted in. And then there's metal nail down the back of it. So you can see that it's repaired. You can see where it's broken. See these little dots? They're woodworm holes. So you can see everything about this harp and how it was made, and how it was put together. The huge chunk of willow wood that this hollow soundbox is made from, and then a separate panel pressed onto the back, and the metal fittings where the string is attached to the front. The strings would run up like this to the tuning pins, and the decorative silver fittings on the front. You can see the grain of the wood in this front pillar. Look, the grain goes up and round the corner and along to there. So you can see that the harp maker has chosen a curved piece of wood to cut the curved component from the harp out of. And like I said, you can spend all day doing that. And Karen spent 8 years doing this for her PhD. And there's still more questions than answers about exactly how the old harps are made and how the tradition worked. So the Queen Mary harp, 14th century, the Brian Boru harp, maybe about the same, although we don't know until the scientific work is done. And these are the oldest harps that survive in Ireland or in Scotland, in the whole of the old Gaelic world that's common to Ireland and the west of Scotland. So these are the oldest harps. But everybody wants to know, well, what happened before? Where did these things come from? And there were harps earlier than this in Ireland and in Scotland. This is in the National Museum in Dublin. It's a little shrine of St. Moog. And it's tiny, it's the size of a postage stamp, and it's made of silver with a layer of gilding on the top. And you can see it shows King David. And he's got his harp in front of him, and there's the bird sitting on top of the harp. Can you see the bird? Right there. And you can see that the harp's got strings, and it's got tuning pins, and it's got a swelling front, and it's even got little fish lips on the front here, just like the Queen Mary and Brian Boru harp have. And so you can get this visceral sense of, yes, people in the 11th century in Ireland knew what the harp was like, and there was a tradition of making and playing harps. But you can't really tell anything specific about this like you can, like with the Queen Mary harp, you can talk about that joint and how the nails are put in and how it's slightly undercut, and the way that the grain of the wood goes, and the wear of the hand showing you exactly that his hand was here, not here. And you can't do that with this, because it's a tiny postage stamp size cartoon. So it can tell you about the way the harp was seen by artists, but it can't tell you about the music in the way that the old instruments can. And the further back in time you go, the less clear it becomes. And so by the time you get back as far as the 9th and 10th century, this is from one of the high crosses at Monaster Boyce, which is on just off the motorway between here and Dublin. And I don't know if you can see very clearly, this is the figure of Christ in the centre of the cross, and then on the arm, which sticks out, there is a man here, and he's playing a trumpet or a pipe, and there's a man here, here's his head, here's his shoulder, here's his arm, here's his hand, here's a triangular thing in front of him, with a bird on the top of it. And so it's a fair guess that that triangular thing in front of him is a harp. But you can't really say anything more than that. It's just a rather fuzzy, worn out image of a man or a person sitting on a chair with a triangular object in front of them. So yeah, they had triangular things that they held in front of them in the 9th century. Before that, there's nothing. But these are the earliest harp-shaped objects in the whole of Ireland that we know of. But that's quite a long way back to trace the idea of harps in Irish culture. Okay. So here's Patrick Byrne. This is where we started. The last of the harpers. And I showed you the slide of Egan's harps to show you how the old Irish harp kind of got replaced by Egan's new invention, which came out of his work in the Anglo-Continental pedal harp tradition. And that new invention, that new portable Irish harp, kind of took over because people who had an Anglo-Continental musical education could play it, and it could change keys and you could play chordal harmonies and so on that fashionable 19th century music required. Whereas Patrick Byrne's old brass-strung Irish harp with its long resonance and its difficult stopping technique. It was only charitable schools for the blind that kept it going in the 19th century. There was no grassroots tradition of playing it. So when the boys got old and died like Patrick Byrne, they didn't have students to pass it on to. Whereas the Anglo-Continental pedal harp and the new portable Irish harp traditions were thriving and fitting into fashionable new colonial ways of living in Ireland. And people knew that. People kind of realised that right the way through. They knew that Egan's new portable Irish harp was not the same thing as the old brass-strung Irish harp. And people tried to do something about it. This is another of Byrne's contemporaries, an even younger lad who was alive right through to the 1890s, but still he didn't pass it on. So what happened instead? Instead of connecting with those who asked of the old students in the old tradition who'd learned in the society school, people did not connect with them. What they did instead was they knew that there was an older tradition of playing harps with brass strings that was separate. And so they tried to go back to the original thing. So you see here in 1892, I think Pat Murney was still alive when this photograph was taken. But she's not going to Pat Murney to learn from a tradition bearer or from somebody who's inherited the tradition back through Arthur O'Neill. She's making it up herself. She's playing on the left side, the harp high up, like a pedal harp. And her harp is a kind of archaeological reconstruction of the medieval harp. And I find this quite interesting, this idea of instead of trying to connect to what's there, you kind of imagine a different world to try and reconnect to. So her harp has metal strings. It's a good archaeological copy of the surviving harps. And here's an example. what she's doing didn't work. You can't play a well set up brass from a replica or a medieval harp as if it was a pale harp, it just doesn't really work. So this is in 1892, which was the first year that there were harp competitions at the Gaelic Song Festival in Scotland. The next year, they got that song. This is another attempt to make a copy of the Brian Drew harp. I think this was Henry, who's the man who did the recordings. So he had one made because he was interested in old Irish traditions.
So we have
movements.
and they thought, well, how can we get beyond that at the moment? And so I'll show you a few of these examples. And Heyman, in the 1970s, got hold of a harp. And it's modeled after Patrick Wynne's harp, that's Otway harp. And we have a couple of downstairs, for those of you who are coming to the workshop, we'll be able to see. And this was our first one. And then she got the second one, which was a couple in the decoration of the old one house. And she performed with it and made recordings. But she did a thing that I don't think anyone else has done before her. And that is, she got a harp that was modeled on one of the 18th century harpers' instruments. And she went to Queens and she looked at Duncairn Arts. And she tried to combine the field draft notations of performance with the replica instrument. So she started off with Quint's harp, and she did look at Quint's tunes, but the mainstream of research has been that she got a copy of this house and down her harp, and she spent a lot of time looking at Bunsen's field manuscripts of the Mississippi repertory. So she, I think she was the first person to do that work, trying to be specific, rather than vagueness of Brian Ruhar and saying, all the lectures used on it, to do that specific work of getting the Daniel Harp and then this half the seconds from the field notebooks on it. Onto a copy of the surviving museum instrument to connect with the